You tell them. Here. Everybody, gather around. Lord of the cats and dogs. It's what I am. The only dog that wanted to come out was little R. Yep. Hey, how you doing? Yeah, not so good. I feel kind of crappy. Well, it's a cloudy day. He seems to feel better whenever the sun's out. He gets out there, clears up his sinuses or whatever it is. It's going to take a while for him to feel better, but I think he's going to be just fine. Clover, on the other hand, she's always fine. I have so many questions today. It's going to be great. It's going to be great. By the way, everybody, welcome to Weekend Edition. Weekend Edition, to those of you who have been living in a box, is, simply put, where you have a question and you need an answer, you ask me. Why? I have no idea. But you do, and I give you the very best answer I possibly can. Some of them I have to research. Most of them I just pop right off the top of my head, so I never really know what's going to come out. Hey, everybody, calm down. Lay some eggs, you worthless feathered buggers. Okay. Oh, one thing I want to clarify. There was one thing from the last Weekend Edition. Remember, I did that in my living room, and everybody was just loving the living room. Thank you. Thank you. I worked really hard on that. It took a few years, but I did it. A little here, a little there, as I had time and as I can afford it. I tried to make the house a lot less haunted looking, like it did when I first moved here. One thing that I mentioned was that I love living in a place that doesn't smell like pee. And some of you caught that. And they said, your house smells like pee? Well, this is what it is. The people who lived here beforehand apparently had a cat and they had a dog. I don't know how many of each that they had. There was also this gosh-awful old carpet that was in there. There was mice, hundreds of mice throughout the house, upper floor, lower floor, basement, attic, everywhere, because the bottom door was rotted and pushed in so every living creature in the world could just come on in and make a home. Well, we had to get rid of all those mice. So, of course, you know, when you have a bunch of mice, they pee and poop everywhere. It reeks. Also, whoever had a cat in there decided that they didn't need a litter box. So one part of the living room over where I was sitting, the old carpet that I recently ripped out, it reeked of pee. Old, stale pee. And every time you'd have the house closed up, it would reek of pee. So I was always having the windows open, but that didn't help me. In the wintertime, I was like, ooh, it's warm in here, but it smells like pee. That's why I'm happy to not have a house that smells like pee, because I ripped out the old carpet, got rid of it, and I bought a rug at a used furniture store and put that down, a nice cozy rug, and I also cleaned the area off and disinfected it. My house smells like a house now. I ask for so little, and I get it. That's why the no pee smell. Anyway, our first guest is Loretta. Good afternoon, Loretta. Hello again. Again? Oh, apparently you must have been here before. Well, hello again, Loretta. I'm planning on getting 4 chickens and 4... Hey, Rascal, stop it. Rascal! No! No! Bad dog. Sorry about that. Yeah, the little baby kitty was getting a little close to Rascal, and Rascal decided to challenge the kitty. Only problem with that is I got Daddy back here, and Daddy protects his babies, and if he was feeling better, he would have cleaned Rascal's clock. That happened before with the mother cat. Rascal just likes to play, and he barks and growls and stuff, and he does that with Clover. Clover's okay because she was raised around him, and she just lays down and puts her paw up and stuff, but when he does it to the other cats, the mother or father will run up and claw him upside the face. And one time he had a good old-fashioned scratch and he was bleeding from his ear. So it's not like I was really angry with Rascal. I just didn't want to have an incident. You got to walk a fine line here, and I want to make sure that he doesn't get in trouble because I have to take care of him. But yeah, he does like chasing cats. Anyway, back to the question. Back to our program. I'm planning on getting 4 chickens and 4 ducks for laying purposes. I do not want males. I have a small backyard. What do you suggest? Well, Loretta, I suggest you say goodbye to your backyard. I've had ducks, I've had geese, I've had chickens, I've had guineas, I've had it all. Turkeys, you name it, I've had it. Well, what happens is, this is the nature of birds. Some folks may tell you different, but I've watched it happen. So those of us who have actually had these creatures and saw them at their best and worst will testify to this. Chickens, for one thing, chickens will peck. And they'll eat all the bugs. They'll eat all the bugs in your yard. It's a wonderful thing. They eat bugs. They eat flies. They eat beetles. They eat everything. They'll clear your yard full of bugs. Second, they will clear your yard of greens because they like grass. They like clover. They like dandelions. They love your garden. Yes, they love your garden. They'll eat everything in your garden. Well, what they're going to do is they're going to eat all the bugs and all the greens out of your yard. It'll take a little while, but they're going to do it. They're going to peck the grass, they scratch, they dig for bugs. That's what chickens do. They're forest birds. They originated in the jungles of, I think, Africa or something like that. They would scratch the forest floor, look for bugs, scratch it some more to move the leaves around. That's what they do in your yard. They scratch, peck, scratch, peck. It's a wonderful thing to watch. Problem is, that constant scratching is disrupting your grass. And they see these little grubs, they see nice little tender roots of your grass, and they peck that up. They're going to wipe out your yard. The ducks... they are going to eat everything that's green because ducks are vegetarians. And well, they do like an occasional grub and worm, but generally they eat all greens. They're going to wipe out the greens as well. And then once all the greens are gone, your chickens are going to dust bathe because the chickens, this is just the reality of these birds, I want to let you know. They're going to dust bathe. They need dust, dirt, dust to get in underneath their feathers, and that will kill any mites that are on their skin, and it keeps them healthy. It's a good thing. But what the bad thing is, they're going to make little dust bowls in your yard. And then when it rains, it's going to get muddy. And it's going to get worse and worse and worse. So eventually, it'll look like a moonscape in your backyard. Ducks, they do need water to get in and also to dunk their beaks in because they eat grain and they eat other stuff. And they muddle through the dirt sometimes for bugs. And they get the dirt inside their nostrils here. And they need to dunk their beak. And this is my version of a beak. They dunk it in the water and they shake it around, which also gets the water dirty. They also like to swim around in there. So if you can get a little kiddie pool, one of those little plastic kiddie pools, you're going to have to keep filling that up, emptying it out once every few days to keep the water from being stagnant and disgusting. The ducks are going to love you for it. But yeah, it's going to be a mess. But you know what? It's also going to be a joy. So if you don't mind your yard looking like a little farmyard, knock yourself out. Go for it. They're going to be fun to raise. Give them an indoor area so they can go in and spend the night and also lay eggs because they don't like to do it outside. You're going to have a blast with this. If you have specific questions on them, feel free to ask. Me or somebody else will get back to you. But I love answering chicken questions. I just love it. I've been raising chickens for decades, so and also other birds, so I know all about them. Donna. Hey, Donna. Ray, I have those gnats in my soil of my houseplants, and I'm upset. I can imagine you would be. Those are fungus gnats, by the way. It's a big plant. I had replaced the soil, and I think they were in the bag of soil that I bought. Yep, they probably were. I can't dump it because it's too heavy. I saw somewhere to mix lavender drops in water and spray and put cinnamon on top of the soil. Actually, sounds like you're making a dessert there. I'm so tired of them. Any suggestions? I got my seeds, and I appreciate you doing that, and thank you so much. Oh, the free seed giveaway. Yeah, I'm getting a lot of people that got those seeds. I just love that. But anyway, back to your thing. I don't know anything about the lavender oil or cinnamon. I've heard cinnamon gets rid of them, but then again, I've heard that it doesn't. There's all different kinds of ways to get rid of them. One way that will work, this is the way that generally works. Okay, there is no method on earth that is 100%. If anybody tells you that, they're full of it. That sounded like a fart. You okay? Whoa, that wasn't me. It was a cat. Anyway, here's what you do. Let the soil in your plant dry out. Don't be tempted to water it, okay? Let it dry out to the depth of a full finger, okay? Preferably your middle finger. I'm not going to show you my middle finger because it's going to look a little bit mean. All right, to the depth of your middle finger, to that depth. Then what you do is you mix up one-fourth hydrogen peroxide, the stuff that you buy at the store, one-fourth that, one-fourth regular water. Mix it up in a container. Water your plant from edge to edge. Every square inch of that top has to be saturated to a depth of your middle finger. What that will do is the peroxide will dissolve the bodies of the babies, the baby grubs that you can't even see that are in the soil. It kills them and it kills the eggs. Done deal. Now, to kill the adults that are flying all around, what you need to do, and you need to do this with every plant in your home because even though you may not see them, they're probably in there as well. Do them all at the exact same time. And then what you can do is you can get fly paper or yellow sticky traps that you can buy online or buy at your garden center. You hang those right around soil level, maybe one per pot. The adults are attracted to yellow, So they'll go there and they'll stick on there. That keeps the adults dead. And then they can't lay eggs in the soil because all you need is one pregnant female to drop some eggs and it's toast again. But that would be the quickest way and it's the less harmful to your plant. You don't have to dump the soil. All right, next one, Pat. Hey, Pat. Ray, what's the difference between green onions and leeks? Oh, that's an easy one. Green onions and leeks are very closely related. They're not the same thing. Leeks look like a green onion that's on steroids. And those of you on foreign countries, you don't call them green onions. You might call them spring onions. Those are just the green little thin onions that you grow in the garden. Green onions are regular onions that are just young, and some of them don't form bulbs. Now, leeks are a horse of a different color. They're a little bit fatter. And the flavor is where the difference is, aside from the size, of course, these giant things that you harvest out of your garden. I've grown leeks before. They are delicious in potato soups, vegetable soups, anything you want. I love the flavor of leeks. It's a mild onion flavor that has undertones of garlic. It's a wonderful thing. Whereas green onions, they have the flavor of onions. Green onions tend to get a little bit more mushy when you cook them, whereas leeks do not. That's the big difference, okay? Rick. Hey, didn't mean to yell. Hey, Rick. Hi, Ray. I was thinking about starting a living mulch. Ooh, I've heard of those. I tried to find some information about using different kinds of clover. Clover. Yep. Okay, anyway. But I can't find a lot of information about using clover as a mulch. What do you think about using clover as a living mulch? And can I use it, for example, underneath pepper and tomato plants to attract bees? Ooh. Clover will attract pollinators, and that's a smart thing to do. Clover also puts nitrogen back into the soil. Clover also will not harm other plants that it's growing around because your tomatoes and peppers put down roots deeper than what the clover generally does. So they're not competing, and also where the clover is, it's going to help feed the soil. So it really doesn't harm your tomato and pepper plants. It's a good thing to put there. Thing you want to do, you want to seed it real heavy. Because although clover will grow on the bottom, it isn't so much of a ground cover that it prohibits other weeds from coming up. It just doesn't do that. It never grows that thick. That's just not the nature of clover. Clover is a plant that will start out where other plants can't because it makes its own nitrogen. It has this relationship with microbes and stuff where it can grow where other plants can't. So it's a starter plant. It grows, it fertilizes soil, and then other plants come in and take advantage of all the work that the clover did. If you want to do this, what I would recommend is seeding white Dutch clover. That's the low-growing clover with the white flowers. Don't do the red clover. Those grow tall. And those flop all over and they look ridiculous. Do the white Dutch clover. Buy yourself some seeds online. I don't sell the seeds on my little shop of seeds, but look online. You can find clover dirt cheap per pound of seeds. And then just rake them all in there, put some soil on top of it, let it go. You're going to be glad you did. I have clover in my garden and I never pick it. I'll pick every other weed, but I never pull the clover. Next one is from Madeline. Hey, Madeline, let me just breeze along on these questions. You don't have all day. And so I want to make sure that I can be as quick as I can with this, but not shortchange you on your answers. Okay, Madeline. Hi, Ray. This year, I purchased some comfrey seeds to grow in my garden, and I want to use these leaves to make a compost tea. I've heard that it's great for the garden, but I've also heard I should never plant this plant in the garden because it can cause people to have health problems. Can you please tell me if you think it's safe to use in my garden? Well, I've never grown comfrey, so I had to look this up. And from my limited understanding, but I did look it up, and I looked on some reputable websites. Comfrey, there are people who are proponents of this and people who are not proponents of comfrey. Comfrey has been used in the past for medicinal purposes, topically on skin, and some places will tell you that it's okay to drink limited amounts of comfrey tea. I am on the position, from what I've read and from what I know and from what I've heard from reputable sources, don't do this. It can cause liver damage. There is a risk of bodily damage with this, and people who know what they're doing may be able to get away with this, but most of us don't know enough to risk our lives with something that can be dangerous. So my advice to you is to play it safe. Don't drink it. Okay? Anything green can be used for a tea. It's called a green tea. You just take green material, grass, comfrey, clover, anything green, leaves, mash them up, chop them up, put them in a bucket, cover it with water, just barely cover it, let it set there for a few days, and then use that to water your garden. It takes the nitrogen out of the greens and it feeds your garden. And then eventually the greens are deteriorating and turning to mush. You can throw that on your garden and use it as a mulch, a mat of mulch. The soil will decompose that and take it into itself, and it'll help feed the garden. So nothing gets wasted that way. But as far as taking it into your body, my position, no. Other people may have different positions. Feel free to post your ideas in the comment section below and help Madeline out. Don't post any links. I don't allow links in there because it really gets kind of crazy. Okay, that was Madeline's. Sanyo Kitty. Love the name. Hey, Sanyo Kitty. Have you heard of using nettle tea as a fertilizer? Oh, well, that's just kind of like the other question. Do you think it'll work? If not, what fertilizer do you recommend for vegetable plants? Like I said in the other one, anything green. Nettle tea is good for your garden. Just take a whole bunch of nettles, mash them up, break open the surface of the plant, mash them up with water, let it set for a few days. Yes, you can water your garden and also use the used up greens after using it a couple times. You can spread it on your garden. It'll decompose on your garden. Yeah, sure will. Gail. Hey, Gail. I tend to yell that out. I'm really sorry about that. I tend to get a little bit crazy. I'm having a good day. It's beautiful out here, so I'm having a good day. I can't wait till spring. I just can't. I'm doing my garden up in my mind and on the computer. I'm ordering stuff for the garden. I'm getting all set. Yeah, it's going to be a great year. Gail. Howdy, Ray. I have a question, so you can hopefully help me with. I live in Illinois, Zone 5B. I used to live in Zone 5B in Illinois. My question is, I see homesteaders on YouTube always talking about planting their spring crops first, then later planting their summer crops. Like you in Iowa, we have a short growing season. Is there such a thing as spring and summer planting for us? I usually plant all my vegetables in the spring when the weather permits. Please help. I'm so confused. It can get so confusing on when to plant. And that's one of the reasons, the main reason, I do not put planting instructions on the Little Shop of Seeds website, because everybody is different. Florida is different from Wisconsin. I can't tell you when to plant these things or how to plant them because your soil is different, your temperature is different, your growing season is different. There is no cookie cutter way to how to plant things. And so when I look on the back of seed packets, that is not good advice for everybody. That's general advice. And everybody's area is a little bit different. So, but with us in the mid part to northern part of the country, in the south, they plant different because they're a warmer zone. So they can plant things in, say, February. Whereas I can't plant stuff in February. I can't even get 2 inches into the soil because it's frozen. So that doesn't work for me. But as a rule of thumb, for us people who actually have a winter where it freezes and we have a summer, we have all the different seasons, here's what you do. In the spring, when your soil is thawed, where you can dig a shovel in and get a whole shovel all the way in and there's no frozen anything, when the last chance of frost is gone, okay, right when that last chance of frost is gone, plant your cold weather crops like coal crops, C-O-L-E. Coal crops are cabbages, collard greens, radishes, things like that are cool weather crops. Your lettuces, you can plant, spinach, they all germinate and grow well in cool weather. As a matter of fact, they grow best in cool weather. So get those in as soon as the last chance of frost is over. Don't worry about the cool soil. They will germinate in cool soil. Then, when the weather gets warmer and you're having nights where you can sit out in a t-shirt and not feel cold, that's the time that you want to plant your warm weather crops like tomatoes, peppers, corn. Corn does not do well early season if you plant it in cool temperatures and soils because it germinates best in warmer soil. And if you have it in cooler soil, the seed can actually rot as it sprouts. And so you'll have spotted germination and not quite so healthy. Some people get away with it, but I think it's like spinning the roulette wheel. Sometimes you win, a lot of times you lose. So that's the difference. The cold crops, the cooler weather crops like lettuces and radishes and stuff, get those started as soon as the frost is over, the warmer weathers, give them about 30 more days, and then get those started. Easy peasy. That's it. Oh, by the way, and if you're confused about what's a warmer weather crop, just type it into Google. They'll help you out, or post it in the comment section below. I'll try to help you as much as I possibly can. Next one, Marsha. Hi, Marsha. I like your channel. You give great, thank you. You give great advice. I try. Sometimes, face plant. Sometimes I hit a home run. How long does it take a peace lily leaf to unfold. My peace lily is looking very sparse. The majority of the leaves are green, but they're not open. It's been like this for a couple of months. I changed the soil, I sprayed the plant with neem oil and inserted Miracle-Gro fertilizer sticks. I also water it once every week and I use a humidifier 3 times a week. I have it by a west-facing window and the temperature is about 67 to 72. Well, first of all, Marcia, you're loving your plant to death. Peace lilies do not need a lot of care, all right? Here's the scoop on a peace lily. Make sure it's got root space, okay? Make sure it's not in a teeny tiny pot. They like to spread their roots out, all right? That's the first thing. And second of all, let the soil dry out just a little bit between watering. There is no time period to watering plants. Some people will tell you water every week, once every 2 weeks. That's hogwash. Every plant's different. You may have a warmer spot. Somebody may have a cooler spot. You have a larger pot. They have a smaller pot, bigger plant, littler plant. We all have different needs. It's just like me and a 300-pound man have different dietary needs. You know, he can't eat just one sandwich for lunch. He's going to need a few chips and a salad or something else. He can't survive on what I survive on. Plants are the same way. They all have different needs depending on how big they are, how old they are, things like that. With a peace lily, rule of thumb, the most general advice I can give you, water it well. Let the soil dry out, but not to where the plant starts wilting. But let it dry out a little bit. Feel your pot, and you'll know after doing your plant for a while. Do not over-fertilize it. That will not help it out, okay? They don't need a lot of fertilizer. One thing that you can do is you can take one of those fertilizer sticks. You can break it in half. Put that in a 5-gallon container with water. Just let it sit in there. That'll give you enough fertilizer water to use for like a week, 2 weeks for all the plants in your house. If that's the only plant you have, maybe not use a half a fertilizer stick, or use that fertilizer stick in your water, but only use it once every 2 to 3 months. You don't really need a lot of fertilizer for those plants. Next, don't go spraying it. Don't go fertilizing it. Leave the neem alone. I don't know what you're using neem for, but that sure as heck isn't going to help your plant grow. It'll keep the bugs away, but it's also stressful for the plant. So back off the neem. Don't use a fertilizer. You don't need that. They don't really require a lot of humidity. Sometimes too much care is just too much care. So back off a little bit. It'll do what it's going to do. It'll be just fine. Next one, Michelle. Hey, Michelle. Hi, Ray. Mentioning cross-pollination, should I plant hot peppers in a different area from green bell peppers? Should I plant different types of tomatoes away from each other? I want to be careful saving seeds so I have the original type of plant. Your advice is needed on this, please. Well, it doesn't matter whether a plant's hot pepper or mild pepper. Some people have actually said, I've actually read this in places, if you plant a hot pepper by a mild pepper, your mild peppers will be hot. That may be in Bizarro Garden, but not in the real world. No. That has nothing to do with anything. I don't know where they dug that one up. That's some kind of book of myths, but no, that's no. That's nonsense. Bad dog. If you want to save seeds from plants, the rule of thumb is 300 feet. That's a long way to go. But then again, pollinators don't care that you want to save seeds. A bee that comes along, he's like, ooh, flower, ooh, a flower, ooh, a flower, ooh, a flower. That's what they do. They pollinate flowers. It's their job. It's what they do. It's all they do. And they're going to just go from plant to plant. So they're going to cross-pollinate. You're going to get fruit from that. And the seeds from that fruit may not grow the same plant, the same type of plant that they came from. It may be a cross. You may have bell peppers that are slightly hot, or you'll have hot peppers that are kind of mild, that look funky. You never know. But you have to plant them at least 300 feet apart to ensure the best chance of no cross-pollination. So if you have a regular size yard, one on one side, one on the other side. Same with tomatoes. That's your best bet of doing that. And I know some people don't like hearing that kind of advice, but that's just how it is. Sometimes we don't like the advice, but that's the best advice I can give. Lori, you're next. Hey, Lori, can you see yourself going vegan? Do you ever feel bad about eating meat? I've been thinking about cutting all animal products out, but I love cheese too much. I know how you feel. One more question. I haven't been able to open my windows or doors in months, probably because it's winter. That's what I'm assuming she didn't say. And I miss the fresh air smell. Do you have any plant recommendations that smell like fresh air? Well, I don't know any plants that smell like fresh air, but if you have a lot of plants in your house, you're going to have a lot more oxygen. They're going to filter that carbon dioxide, that stuffiness, and it's always going to smell fresh in your house. In the Voodoo Garden, my house may smell like dog or everywhere else because I have the dogs. But when I go down in the Voodoo Garden, it's an enclosed room. I go in there and I get this charge of fresh air. I feel energized. I feel wonderful. I feel like a new person again. It's all the oxygen. I'm getting high off the oxygen. And it always smells good. It smells green. And that's the fresh smell you want. More plants. Okay, now let's get to the slightly more difficult question about going vegan. Oh, you know what? I might have to cycle the camera. Turn it off and turn it on so that it doesn't turn itself off. I don't want to get cut off in mid-question. Hold on, just a moment. Yay, I'm back. You, park yourself on my lap. Okay, back to the vegan question. Or don't park yourself on my lap. Anyway, the vegan question. I tried vegetarianism. I don't even know how to pronounce it. I tried a vegetarian diet back in 1981. It lasted, I think, 2 to 3 weeks. And I just couldn't do it. Because my mindset wasn't vegetarian. I'm not vegetarian at heart. I'm not vegan at heart. I'm an omnivore. And I'm okay with that. So you have to be okay with your choices in life. Do the very best you can to make the choices that are good for you. One person's choice may not be another person's choice. So we have to respect that everybody's going to be a little bit different. Daddy, she don't want you near me. She's very possessive. And you know what? He has so much respect for his daughter. She hits him upside the head and he's like, well, okay, I want her to be happy, but you know, you are my daughter. Okay, anyway, back to the vegetarian and vegan. I can't see myself going vegan or vegetarian. That's just not my way. I'm an omnivore. I eat plants. I eat meat. I eat grains, cheese, milk products, the whole array of food products. That's just my dietary choice. Now, as far as feeling bad about eating meat, I don't feel bad about eating meat. This is just my way, okay? And vegetarians and vegans sometimes have a very strong opinion about those of us who do eat meat. And I don't want to get into any kind of argument or battle over save the planet and you're killing animals and the suffering of animals. I don't like that animals would have to suffer. I don't. I mean, come on, you know me. People, they know me. I don't want any animal to suffer. That's just not my way. But I'm an omnivore, and I eat meat. And there was a time when I used to butcher my own animals and eat that. I don't do that anymore because I just don't want to do that anymore. I didn't like the flavor of home-raised meat. I wish it would be perfect if the animals that are raised for food were treated humanely, were processed humanely as possible with no pain and suffering. If they could live out a decent life, that would be ideal. It would be good. I am all for that. There are ways to raise animals for food that I think are far better than what we're doing. There are ways to raise plant material that we eat in a far better way than what we're doing because the industry is so messed up. It is. The farming industry is so messed up with chemicals, ways of doing things, not caring for the environment, the same way with raising animals for food. But I don't know what the solution to that would be. But I can say that no, I won't be going vegan. I won't be going vegetarian. I won't be making excuses or apologies for it because that's just my choice. So that's my answer. No, I can't see myself doing that. Next one is from Salt Aaron Sway. I don't know if I got that right. I'm sure hoping I do. Do you do any food preservation like fermentation or dehydrating herbs for making your own spices? I used to. Yeah, I have two dehydrators. I used to dehydrate a lot. That was fun for a while, and then I got over it. I didn't want to do it anymore. I tried dehydrating tomatoes. Didn't like dehydrated tomatoes. I did apples. They grossed me out. I do like freezing my food. I used to do a lot of canning. Oh, I loved canning. I would can tomatoes, green beans, boiled eggs. I made my own pickles, my own tomato jam. You name it, I made it. I had a pantry that was overstocked with that. That was fun. But I don't do that anymore. I have changed what I do. Now, if I want to preserve anything, I freeze it because I have a chest freezer just for that. It's energy efficient. It holds a lot of food. I don't have to go through all the pressure canning and stuff. That's just my way. Some people don't prefer that way. They prefer to can. That's perfectly fine. But No, I don't really do a lot of it anymore. I grow my garden mainly for fresh eating. The tomatoes and peppers, yeah, I will freeze those because I can use them throughout the winter, but other than that, I don't do a lot. No, I sure don't. Next one is Rick. Hey, Rick, I'm growing seeds. Me too, Rick. I'm growing seeds and many have sprouted. At what point do I plant in my raised beds? I'm in zone 10. We have no winter. Aw, you poor thing. You have no winter. I don't see me crying for you. You poor thing without your winter. Yeah, Rick, I know where you live. You're way down there. But as far as when to plant, I have no answer because I don't grow down there. So I don't know. For me, I grow in the early spring, but I've heard that people down south, like way down in Florida and Alabama and the southern states, they plant at weird times that people like us, we couldn't possibly think of planting. So if there's any lower zone, like zone 9 and 10, if you have any ideas for Rick, chime in, okay? Because that's where I love this. If I don't have an answer, I know there's somebody out there. I got thousands of you out there. So I know some of you have an answer for Rick, and you can help him far better than me. So I don't want to give him any kind of bad answer. Do you have answers? Post it here for Rick. When's he going to plant? Okay? I think it has to do with your plants too. So maybe you might want to specify what you're planting because different things get planted at different times. Next one, Tyler. Tyler, hey, how you doing? Do you have any advice on growing succulent plants? Because I just bought two and my leaves on the plants are dying and they're by a window getting enough sunlight. Thank you in advance. Well, Tyler, one thing I might want to bring up is that succulents, of course, are generally hot weather plants, maybe desert plants. They generally do well with lack of water. That's why they're succulents. They store the energy in their leaves and or roots. Doesn't mean that they're going to do well by a window because outside in a desert environment, it may get hot, but you have air circulation. By a window, that's almost like putting them in an oven because the window will generate a lot of heat really fast, yet the plant and the area around there can't disperse that temperature fast enough. And also, out in its natural environment, it's in the ground where it could have an extensive root system and there could be a lot of soil on top of those roots. Whereas indoors, it's in a pot. And that pot will suck up the heat a lot more than the outside ground. So it may be going through some stress and dropping those leaves. One thing that you could do is move it just a little bit farther from the window or put it by a window where it doesn't get quite as much sun. Also, make sure you water them enough. Just because they're succulents doesn't mean they want to be dry all the time. With mine, I have an aloe growing downstairs in the voodoo garden. It gets a lot of light, not a lot of heat, and it does just fine. So what I do is I flood it really good with water. I don't let it set in water. It has a drip tray. And so any water that comes out the bottom, I get rid of. I flood it, let it get bone dry. Let it stay bone dry for a couple weeks, flood it again. It seems to love that. And it seems to simulate its natural environment because in deserts, that's what it does. Dry for a while, flood. Dry for a while, flood. And don't give it too awful much heat. I don't think that's doing it any good. And my plant drops a few leaves off the bottom too. So it's really not a big deal. Just pluck them off, get rid of them. That's how they grow. They get rid of bottom leaves. Most plants will do that. And Gigi. Or Gigi, I think it's Gigi. I'm gonna say Gigi. Hi, Gigi. Do you? Poor thing. No more pills for you. You've had enough. Enough antibiotics for him. Okay, Gigi, do you still have your coffee plant? No, I haven't had that for years. I had water issues and it didn't handle the alkaline water. It just dropped dead. Mine's in a good size vase, I guess you mean pot, but it seems to be just surviving with no signs of growth. Any particular tips for a coffee plant? Yes, give it time. Coffee plants love rich, well-drained soil. Make sure your soil is rich and well-drained. It loves rich potting soil because it's a temperate plant from down south, like in Central America or South America, and they have good, rich, fertile soil down there. They appreciate that. They like medium to medium bright light, but mine didn't respond well to super bright light. So keep the light medium to bright. Don't put it by a southern window or anything. It might harm the plant. But the soil is the big thing, and also give it time. It puts out, mine would put out a lot of leaves. It'd wait, recharge a little bit, put out leaves. It kind of grew in jumps and starts for me. So maybe that's how it is for you. Oh, by the way, where did you get that nice wood chair? That was on the last weekend edition. That really isn't much of a nice chair. Somebody else mentioned that too. That just came with a dining table that I got a long time ago. It's just some old chair. It looks nice, doesn't it? But I just put it there to put stuff on. Like when I don't want the dogs to get at something, I'll put it over there on the chair so they don't sniff at it. Next one is from Sahib333. Hey, Sahib. I heard a door. The cats are breaking into my house again. Do you spray insecticides such as neem oil during the budding flowering stage of any plant? Is it really harmful? If so, how can one take care of insects during that period? Ooh, Sahib. Let me inform you on that. I actually found out about this 2 years ago when I was trying to find out about my apple tree having this weird fungus issue with some other trees. Anyway, this is how you do it. You can spray neem oil to get rid of insect problems on your tree, but spray it no later than 2 weeks before the flowers open up. Once the flowers are about ready to open up, don't touch it, okay? Because what that does is it leaves a residual, and any kind of pollinating insects that come over to those flowers may die. So you're harming your plant if it flowers, okay? So within 2 weeks of it flowering, don't spray. Early spring, well, it still has little tiny buds that are real close and tight. Give it a good spring. All over, up and down, top to bottom, soil, trunk, everything, the whole plant. Give it a good spray when it's not a sunny day, when it's a cloudy day. Then, don't spray it again until after the flowers have been pollinated and they're starting to fall. Once the flowers have been pollinated and they're starting to die off, spray it again. That'll get rid of the next wave of insects. And spray it, I think, twice a month, no more than twice a month, and that will keep the insects under control. Anyway, best of luck on your plant. Next one, look at us just flying through Weekend Edition. She's keeping my lap warm. It's kind of getting kind of cool because it's evening here. I'm not filming in the morning, I'm filming in the evening, so the sun's going down, she's keeping me warm, my hands are getting kind of cold, but that's early spring. Well, I keep calling it early spring, but it's just late winter. Still, it's like the beginning of March, but it seems like it should be later on in the season. I guess I'm getting antsy. Mary, you're next. Hi, Ray. What do worm castings do for the garden? Worm castings, Mary, will add, what worms do when they, worm castings are worm poop, for those who don't know. Worms go in, they go out, they go up, they go down, they go round and round, they go all through the soil. And what they do is they eat decomposing matter, like dead decomposing leaves, plants, dead fungi, everything in the soil. They go through there and they shove it in their little worm mouth. It goes through the worm and it comes out the back. It's almost a constant process. So what they're doing is they're taking everything digestible out of the soil and pooping it out. And their poop is high in bacteria and enzymes. Enzymes help the soil. And also, the bacteria are good for the soil as well. Their gut in their stomach is a breeding ground for all of that. So worms, that's what they do for the soil. They don't so much fertilize it because worm castings are very low fertility. So they don't really fertilize it, but they do add an extra ingredient. It's kind of like in the way of like if you cook a dinner. It might be a good salad or something like that, but until you add the seasonings to it, it's just a salad. So that's what it is. It's actually the icing on the cake. They are essential though. So if you ever see worms outside your garden, toss them in your garden. If you ever see worms in your garden, try not to kill them. Next one is from Elena. Hi, Elena. I love that name, Elena. Hi, Ray. You mentioned that keeping soil healthy, it should be sprayed with fungicide in the spring as part of preparing the garden. Do you do that? No, I don't. I don't know where that would have come from. I don't remember. I don't remember a lot of things. I don't remember what I had for dinner last night, but I don't remember ever saying, spray your soil in the spring for fungus. Maybe if you have a fungus issue, that would be a good thing to do, is to spray the soil for fungus, but not if you don't have a fungus problem. If you do, spray it. If you don't, no need to do it. My way of gardening is, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. So there is no need to overthink things. If you put compost in your garden, if you have a healthy soil, generally you're not going to have fungus issues as bad. And if you do, spray it for fungus. What else should be done to the soil in spring to prepare for planting? Compost. Till that soil, get the compost in there. Also, turning the soil. Some people don't go with the turning the soil method. They think it's better to leave the soil alone because you don't disrupt the microbes in the soil. My point of view is those microbes don't care. They don't, because they're living in the soil. It's not like they're a little tiny microbes, and they're like, oh no, here comes the sun. No, they don't care. You're mixing them up, and you're getting the stuff on the top into the soil. The compost, the dead leaves that stayed there over the winter, all this stuff gets incorporated into the soil, and it feeds the soil, and it brings the stuff up from in the soil, like weed seeds that might have gotten in there, and bug eggs that might have been in there. It disrupts the soil, and it disrupts the cycle of bad things in your soil. So that's one thing you can do, is turn your soil, break up the clods, do that a couple times before planting season, and when the weeds start coming in, turn it again, and then once you start planting, you don't have to turn it anymore. Get the compost in there too. Let's see, I'm a newbie gardener and I don't have a regimen in place for spring yet. Your advice would be appreciated. Well, that's my advice. Compost, compost, compost. You can't go bad. Kabuki Arts. Hey, Kabuki Arts. Ray, I need help. Aw, okay, I will help you. I bought a house in Arizona that has some fruit trees, mandarin and orange, and I think lemons. Oh, boy, are you lucky. I'm envious. But they're in a small space beside cement, so I need to fertilize them. But how do I do that when I can't get to the dirt around their crown drip line because they're surrounded by cement? There's also some palm trees. I have the same issue. How should I water them and take care of them? Some people said a slow drip watering method would work. That is one issue that city dwellers and people that have areas where there's sidewalks and stuff, they have issues with that. And trees do need to be fed and watered. And people, they see a big tree and they think, it's taking care of itself. Well, maybe, but maybe not. And everything's going to be better if we help it out. Just give it a helping hand, especially when we take something away. If you take something away, you have to add something to keep that balance. That's the way I think. That's the way I live my life. We have to have a balance here. Too much of one thing or not enough of one thing, it gets all out of whack and something goes awry. So when you have a tree and you have a sidewalk going by and you have a street, you know, the road over here, and you got this little circle where the tree's planted, not a lot of water is getting down in there. And also, more importantly, not a lot of fertilizer, because the way trees feed themselves is the leaves fall from the tree, they decompose, the soil takes back into it, and it feeds the tree. The worms will go in, they'll go out, they'll decompose those leaves, the bacteria, the mold, the fungi, it all goes to feeding the trees. When you take that away, how do you think that tree's going to feed? It might have nutrients from way down in the soil, but those may not be enough to have a totally healthy tree. And then you have a tree that slowly dies, or it doesn't look that good. One way that you can help feed it is the drip. Around where the trunk is, where it goes into the soil, you put a little drip hose, you run that thing, start it at night, let it run all night to just slowly go in there, not like bleed over the edge, slowly go in there all night, maybe do that like once a week, and give that tree some water. That's the best that you can do. Also, if you have compost tea, you can put that around there, just water it. Anytime that you can think about it, put some compost tea in there or some fertilizer. They also have tree fertilizer stakes that you just hammer into the ground at the base of the tree. That's something that you can do. It's not ideal, but that's the best that you can do to keep them growing. And best of luck on your trees. Websey Wonky. Wongy. What about drinking charcoal? Oh, God. How about no? Some people, I guess, drink charcoal to, I don't know, to flush out toxins in their system. I'm not going to get into that. I'm just going to say flat out, no, I'm not drinking charcoal, okay? There are other ways for me to take care of my body. Some people may swear by it. I'm not one of those who do. We all have our opinions. My position is charcoal does not enter Ray's body. I got better things I could eat than charcoal, but I don't think that's really necessary. What's the best soil to use to plant herbs? Well, to plant just about anything, rich, well-drained soil. I'm like a broken record. You can always count on me to say that because it always does well for everything. I mean, what plant wouldn't do well with rich, well-drained soil? I've even grown orchids in it. I've grown cactus in it. I've grown everything in rich, well-drained soil. It works. As long, and the trick is, some plants like cactus, they, rascal, no. The cat don't like you. I'm sorry. Everybody loves you, but the cats don't. They just don't, baby. I know. Want to come up here? No? Well, okay. Anyway, with desert plants, cactus, succulents, and things, you might want to have it a little bit more well-drained, but still have some richness in there. I've taken regular soil, added some compost, vermiculite, you can add sand, and make it even more like a desert thing, but there's nutrition in there, and that will help them. You can actually grow a cactus in that, and you'll be surprised at how well they do. You can grow an orchid as long as you don't put too much soil, more well-drained than soil. And as far as growing things, anything, especially herbs and stuff, because herbs, you go for the flavor, you go for the richness, you go for the robustness of that little plant, and that's where the richness of the soil comes in. You don't get something from nothing, okay? So what you put into your soil, you're going to get out of your soil. If you want to put crap in there, don't be surprised when you get crap out. So yeah, put in some compost, maybe water with compost tea. That's going to go a long way. Judy Macaro. Hey, Judy. Do you have, we're getting towards the end. This is a long weekend edition. We had a lot of questions. You guys took me up on it. When I said ask your questions, you took me up on it. Do you have any advice about how to organically protect my stone fruit trees from the stone fruit tree borers? I'm losing my peach trees and cherry trees. Quick answer for you. Yes, I researched that because I was unsure about exactly what they were. For the tree borers, they generally go in through, they lay their eggs in the soil or in the bottom part of the tree, the lower foot of the tree trunk. One thing you can do is early spring, once you start out in spring before everything starts getting going, every 2 weeks, get some neem oil, mix it with water as directed. The strongest, I think it's but you're supposed to go by the directions. Mix the neem oil with water, shake it up because it's an oil. So you're going to have to shake it really good to get a suspension. Water around the plant out to a foot all the way around the plant, the tree, and then also spray the trunk up to a foot and a half. What that will do every 2 weeks, no more, no less. What that will do is that will kill the eggs and kill the grubs and also kill the adults that are emerging out of the ground at that time. Do that every 2 weeks from the beginning of the season to the end of the season. It won't harm your tree, but it will kill those insects and keep them under control. Best of luck on your trees. ABC123. That's the name. ABC123. Do you do a lot of canning to eat in the winter? Do you have much left over? No, I'm sorry. I already answered this in the other question. No, I do no canning anymore. I used to, but I just don't anymore. I just don't have time and I don't have the will to do it. Someday, maybe I will because I'm having more fruit trees and that I can't freeze as well. I got two pear trees. I got a couple apple trees. I have a cherry tree. I'm going to be getting other kinds of stuff. So I may get back into canning. And if I do, I'm going to show you how I make jams, jellies, syrups, all kinds of good stuff. So stay tuned for that. Walster 59. Hey, Ray. Great vids. I always follow you. Hey, thanks. I have a question. I'm trying so hard to grow tomatoes in pots, but no matter what I do, I just don't seem to get the results that others do. I live in Australia. Hey, down under. I live in Australia and use a Bailey's potting mix. Okay, I'm not familiar with that. We don't have that up here. Which is considered to be top of the range, and it comes in a bag. I'm always confused when I watch YouTube videos in Canada or the USA when people talk about compost and bagged soil. What's the difference? I hope this question isn't too confusing. Well, actually, it's not confusing at all. We have just different ways of talking around here. Let me sit down here. You don't agree, do you? Sorry. There. You can come down here. Hey, little R. Yeah. Little R doesn't want to sit on that. Okay, here in the good old USA and in some parts of Canada, we call soil dirt. Okay, dirt or soil. And we call compost something that is organic matter that is decomposed that you add to soil. So that's compost, and dirt is dirt or soil. Those are how we call them. We call them, and also things like I think it is in Britain. Maybe you do it down in Australia. You call your yard a garden, and we call it our yard, and you call it a garden, and you also call your garden a plot. And I think that's kind of cool. I love the way other people in different countries say these things, but that's the difference. But as far as growing your tomatoes, did you have a question about tomatoes? I don't know about the potting mix, but as far as growing your stuff, the best way that I can say is to take your soil and then add some compost, the way I explained it. Add the compost at a rate of about maybe 1/3 compost or 1/2 compost to 1/2 dirt, mix it up in the pot, and that's going to be your best bet for growing tomatoes, peppers, just about anything in your pots. V. Hey, V. Should I use composted manure or an organic liquids tea this season? Either one will work, or both. See, that's the nice thing about these organic fertilizers like compost and compost tea. You can't overdo it. If you use inorganic, sometimes you can over-fertilize and it burns the leaves. You can't overdo it on compost and compost tea. It's perfect. So, no, you can use both. They're growing in raised beds and in above-ground tables. Yeah, get that compost, mix it in there, and then also, if your plants need a boost and they're not doing so good, use a little compost tea. You'll be just fine. Outdoorsman is coming up next. Hello, Ray. I was wondering if you have ever considered growing a massive pepper plant again, like the one you had in the Voodoo Garden years ago. I remember that one. It was a ghost pepper. Those of you who remember, way back when, in 2012 or 13, when I lived in Minnesota, indoors in the Voodoo Garden, I grew this plant in a 16-inch pot. It turned out to be like 5 or 6 feet tall. One of them was a scorpion plant, about 6 feet tall, and scorpion peppers. They were super hot. It was like a tree and had scorpion peppers on it. And the other one was about maybe 4 to 5 feet tall and 4 to 5 feet across. Yes, and it was a ghost pepper. I grew that thing indoors, and I had to keep pruning it back because it was getting too big. And then what I did was I took it outside, and I let it spend its last season outside. It got humongous, and it grew so many peppers. I took them out, and I spread them out all on the kitchen table to show you what one pepper plant can do if you let it really go. That was a good series on growing peppers to show people, not to show off, but to show people, yes, you can do it. I'm not using anything special. I'm just doing regular stuff. Follow these instructions and you can do it too. So that was fun. I might. I don't know. I got to find a good plant. It depends on the pepper plant, and I might have a contender growing in the Voodoo Garden. I'm just going to have to wait and see. So tune into the Voodoo Garden and find out. Okay, that's where I'm going to be growing. Not out here. I don't have enough time to grow it that big. I'll be growing it indoors if I do. Well, my camera shut off right in the middle of a sentence. Oh, I'm going to have to start all over again. Okay, let's go back to the other question. I'm sorry about that. I have such a piece of crap camera, but I make do with what I have, and that's just what I'm going to have to do. All right, Lisa again. Lisa said, let's see, just wondering, how many orders you send out with your seed giveaway this year, and can you tell us some interesting places they went to? Let me tell you, the seed giveaway, in a nutshell, is where I give away free seeds January 1st to January 31st every single year. The reason I do that is for two reasons. One is that I appreciate everything that people do for me. They make donations, they help me out here on the farm, and that is priceless. I do appreciate that every single person that helps out here and sends in a donation. I do love that. The animals appreciate it, everybody here. It really helps us make ends meet, because I am on a budget. But also, the second reason I do this, and the main reason I do this, is because I want to encourage people to try growing stuff. The joy I get, and I talked about it in my book, that gardening saved my life, and it literally did. It was something that helped me find a light at the end of a very dark tunnel in my life when I didn't think I was going to survive. And it's in my book. I wrote a book. And the link's always below my program, and it gets into some very graphic, very detailed details about my life that I wanted to explain to people so that you can understand why I do what I do and who Ray really is, aside from what you see on the camera. But anyway, I want people to understand what I, as much as they can, what I understand about gardening and what you can get from it, when all you have to do is open yourself up to the possibilities. And that's why I send out the seeds, to give you an excuse to grow something. You get the seeds in the mail and you're like, well, I really should grow these, and then you do. And just one little seed sprouting, it can get you so excited. The things that you can see, the things that you can do with it. And then you get food on top of that. And also to maybe, if you have children, to show them what can be fun, what a joy something other than a video game or a TV can be, to maybe inspire them and to instill in them so that maybe down the line they can. If we don't, who will? Huh? The TV's not going to do it. Society's not doing it. If we don't teach the next generation about this, who's going to do it? So I took it upon myself to at least do what little I could do, and that's what I do. But as far as sending them out, I don't count how many goes up because there's no way I could. I wouldn't have time to do anything. But I know that it's well over 10,000. 10,000 every single year. Seed packets being done up, letters, envelopes. It goes. It is such an incredible event. I can't even explain the logistics of this. It overwhelms the post office. It overwhelms our mailbox. It consumes our lives. But you know what? It's a labor of love. I wouldn't have it any other way. And the weirdest places, I send them all over the world. I send them to India, Pakistan, Africa, Asia, all over the planet. I have never sent one to Antarctica. Can you imagine them growing stuff down there? But anyway, I've sent them everywhere. But the weirdest places I've ever had them arrive is back here. Yes. Every year I send out countless boxes of envelopes of seeds all over the planet. And yet I still get all kinds of them back. Return to sender, improperly addressed, address unknown, no such address. And I'm thinking, you don't know your own address? What is wrong with you? The thing is that I take the time to do up these seeds, and I extend myself to send these to you. And the ones overseas, I pay the postage for, and that's not cheap, okay? And I take the time to do this because I want you to enjoy yourself. And all I want is for you to know your address. So I get these seeds back, and I can't use them because I don't know how they were cared for in the mail. So I can't reuse them or sell them or give them away. So I have to just put them in this bag and spread them around my property. So it's wasted seeds. All I ask is please, when you do the seed giveaway every January, please be sure to put the proper address on there, because I know you're probably wondering where your seeds went. Ray didn't send me seeds. To heck with Ray. He's not doing his job. I did my job. It's not my fault that I got the wrong address. I don't know what your real address is. So, yeah, those are the weirdest places I've ever sent seeds to myself. Nancy, we got three more questions, okay? Three more questions. Nancy. Hi, Nancy. I'm watching a Q&A episode of yours from 9 months ago where you talk about your turkeys dying. Oh, wow. Was that 9 months ago? I think it was longer than that, but I mentioned my turkeys dying. Yep. I wanted to tell you that we had chickens and turkeys years ago. One by one, the turkeys died. That will tend to happen sometimes. The feed store guy told us, you cannot raise turkeys and chickens together. The turkeys get something from the chickens. What do you think? I've heard that many, many, many times. It's a disease called blackhead. Yeah, teenagers, we all know about blackheads. But no, it's not the same thing. It's not acne. Blackhead is a disease caused by a protozoa, which is a microscopic little booger. It's caused by that, but it's blamed on a worm. Some kind of a worm parasite. The worm isn't what causes it. The worm is the carrier of the protozoa. And sometimes, commonly, it's found in the parasite that gets into the digestive system of the chicken, and they poop it out, and then it gets into the barnyard, and the protozoa is picked up by the turkeys, and they catch that disease. The chickens generally don't suffer, but they're the carriers of this parasite. And the turkeys are very susceptible to it. That's why in ye olden times, and also in poultry farms, where the area where they're raised, it's always a constant area and it never changes. Once you get infected, it's hard to get rid of that. So you don't want to raise those two together. That was the practice back in the day. I don't have that problem. I've never had blackhead with any of my turkeys and chickens, and I've raised them together for years. So it's not that it causes it, raising them together. It's just that if your chickens have that parasite, it can cause it. So it's a correlation, but it's not a causation, I think, is that that's what it's called. I've never had a problem. But if you ever have a problem, make sure that you separate those animals by a long distance, because it can be spread. Next one is George. Hey, George. Oh, John George. Sorry. John George. Hey, Ray, have you ever planted kohlrabi? Never. But my Uncle Charlie, from my mom's third, fourth, fifth, I don't know. My mom's been married so many times. But he grew kohlrabi in his garden. And that was the first and only time I've ever had kohlrabi. And it's this big weird thing with a green thing, and it grows above ground, and it's kind of turnipy in a way. I loved it. I love kohlrabi. I don't grow it, but I like it. So every now and then I'll buy one and I'll have one. I just slice it real thin, hit it with a little salt and pepper, and I eat it raw. I don't cook them. I don't have them any special way. But no, I've never grown them. Somebody meowing out there. Huh. I'll go check it later. Okay, last one is from Linda. Linda, I wanted to put your question towards the end because it was a very poignant, serious question that I think deserved a good, solid answer from me. Linda says, and this is about pets. She says, "Hi, Ray. I'd like to know your thoughts about knowing when it's time to put a pet down, which means to end their life." Oh, gosh, Linda and everybody, that is the hardest, worst, and yet most profound part of raising pets and companions for me. I have had countless animals come into my life, and I've cared for so many. I've had successes, I've had failures, I've had births, I've had deaths. I've seen it all. And the hardest part, Rascal, what are you eating? Ugh, I don't want to think about what he's eating. It's probably something that I don't want to know. Yeah, he'll throw it up later. That's what dogs do. But the hardest part is that I am their caretaker. I am the decider. I am the one who has to make sure that they're well cared for. If I take on the responsibility of an animal as a pet, as a companion, and I don't take on responsibility for all animals. Not every creature that crosses my path is considered a pet for me. I just don't have the means for that. So if I decide that they are my companion, then I take on that responsibility. And my mantra is, I will never leave you. And I make sure I tell every single companion of mine, I tell them that. I say it to their face, I will never leave you. And what that means is, I will never let you down. I will never let you suffer. You will never be found wanting for anything in your life as long as I have the means and the will to do it. And I do have the will to do it. I will give them the very best life I possibly can under whatever circumstances come my way. And sometimes that decision means that it's time to say goodbye. And that's the hardest thing to do. It's hard for me to talk about because so many memories come to my mind and so many situations have come where an animal, a companion, is old or they're sick beyond repair, and it's a kindness to take them out of their pain and to let them go. And I have to be the one that does that. Oh, it's awful. It is horrible, but I do it. And I do it without fail. And there will come a time when every animal that you see on this program, it's time for them to go, and I'll be the one that has to take care of them. I bury them. I say a few words to them. I think of them. I remember them. They're always going to be a part of my life. Even though they're not here anymore, they'll always be a part of my life. And you know one thing that I don't understand? I just don't understand it. I cannot, for the life of me, come to grips with this and wrap my head around the thought process that we are doing a kindness to our animals, our animal friends, our companions, by ending their suffering when it's time. Yet, with the people that we love so much and we care for so much, when they are in that situation where life is so unbearable and they just want to be let go, that it is against the law to offer them the same compassion that we offer animals. And people will tell you, human lives are more valuable than animals. Some people will tell you that, whether you believe that or not. If you believe that, then why wouldn't it be a consideration that we would give to human beings? I am a full proponent, and I cannot be swayed from this, that it should be our right and our obligation to our loved ones to help them when the time comes to ease their pain and to let them go and to give them some dignity in letting them go. That's just my way of thinking. And with that, I'm going to say goodbye. And I'm going to wish you all a good week. Have a great week. And if you have any questions concerning anything in your life, anything in your garden, pets, cooking, you name it, if you have a question, whether it be about me, you, anything else in this world, post it in the comment section below. I'll be more than happy to add it to a future weekend edition and answer your question to the very best of my ability. And with that, I want to wish you a great week. Take care, everybody. How you doing, huh? Oh, that feels kind of good.